sure by now that you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I raise my hands to praise the God who gives and takes away. I'll praise you in this storm, if I will lift my hands. You are who you are, no matter where I am. If every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and you're my heart is told. I will praise you in this storm. Remember when I stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry to you, you raised me up again. My strength is almost gone, how can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, mercy falls. I raise my hand to praise the God who gives and takes away. I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. For you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, to the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes unto the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, maker of heaven.
Mark's going to actually come up here in a minute. I don't know where he's at. I'll just have to talk until he gets here. But I have a few announcements before we get to that point anyway. Tonight there is the Bible for Dummies class here in Sanctuary at 7 p.m. So that's always a good thing. If you have what that is, if you don't know, have any clue what I'm talking about, is it is just a time to come and learn about the Bible. Mark goes to the Bible in a couple months, so that'll last until December, halfway through December, or something like that. It's going to be Psalms through Song of Solomon tonight, so if you guys have interest in that, that'll be tonight at 7 p.m., as well as we will have youth group tonight. We're going through a six-week study of Goliath Must Fall. This week is all about anger, so unfortunately, we all deal with anger in our life, so tonight we'll be going through a study on how to defeat that. So excited for that. There are lots of opportunities just to be involved. Men, Monday night Bible studies are no longer here at the church. They are at Pastor Mark's house on Monday nights at 7 p.m. If you want to know more about that, talk to Kyle Hunt. He is around here somewhere. More than happy for you guys to go to that. There is there's worship exercise on Monday nights at 6 p.m. at Light at Church. If you've been looking to be involved in maybe worship and exercise in one, Karen Anderson does a wonderful job at all that. So that's Monday nights at LifeNet. Talk to her. Her number's actually here in the bulletin if you have any questions for that. Next week, excited, right after this service, a baptism. So if you've been desiring to be baptized, it's just the outward expression of what Jesus has done in your heart. Next Sunday is an opportunity for you to do so in front of your church, in front of your family. So next Sunday after this service, baptism. Just talk to Mark, talk to me, talk to anyone about it. It's a wonderful, amazing, exciting thing. There is a weekend of prayer coming up 2 weeks from now, November 10th. There'll be a sign-up sheet probably next week for that wonderful thing that's coming where the church prays the whole weekend nonstop. So excited for that. Looks like if there's a Christmas missions trip to Haiti, if you have a desire to do that, be part of that. It's to give toys out to over 10,000 kids December 11th through 17th. If you're interested in that, talk to Steve Ford. And just lots of things. Want to say thanks to whoever went out to the Kingdom Kids Party out there in St. Paris. Wonderful time, good time. Lots of pizza and corn maze and pumpkin matcha and all that good stuff. Danielle did a good job. I know Cole really had a good time, so Cole had a good time, and these other kids had a good time, so just blessed by that as a parent myself. Just lots of good things that just excited about, just blessed that you guys could be here. Here's Mark.
Hey everybody, good morning, good to see you. You playing drum today? Yeah, okay, I was going to make a joke, but I'll just pass. Good morning, everyone. Today is our election Sunday, and once a year we have to allow you, we are thrilled to allow you to elect the leaders in our church again, okay? So that's how we told the state of Ohio we would do it. So our church runs with a group of elders and a group of deacons. The elders do the ministry of the church. The deacons do the business of the church. I believe that's how the Bible sets it all up. We're trying to be as biblical and all that as we can be. So if you don't mind, right now I'd like to introduce the elders of our church to you so we can try to get their votes up. That's a joke. You're not laughing. So if the elders would come right now. I don't know why I have to call for them a couple of times. They kind of know I need them. Come on, Dave. Joe's somewhere, isn't he? Joe's right behind, or Joe right there. Mike's upstairs. Upstairs? That doesn't do me much good at all, sis. I'm sorry. No, let's just stay right here. Joe wanted to stay down here. So we're staying down here. Okay? Because Joe, yeah, there's a bunch of folks up there. All right. So these two fellas, Dave Hamilton and Joe Ford, have been elders here at our church for a long time. Michael Morris is the other elder president in our building, but he's upstairs working with kids right now. Okay? I think you know Mike. So these guys would love to have a yes vote from you. They do just about anything for you to get that today. So if you need something done around your house, just or on your car, Dave will come mow your grass or whatever. So I'm just kidding. Volunteering us for stuff. All right. So those are those men elders that would like to have your votes today. Good men. been a blessing to the church for a long time. The new thing this year is I am trying to elect three, like for you to elect three new elders in our church, okay? Brian Ward is one of those. Brian Ward is upstairs right now in my office helping a lady that is struggling and needs some propane, so he can't come down here right now. So that's where Brian is right now. The other two elders we'd like to elect today, one is right there. I think he was just on the stage here, Justin Raines. Come on, Justin. Okay, and then Clay right here. I'd like to tell you about these guys. I think you know Brian, right? You guys know Brian Ward? Brian's been a deacon in our church for a lot of years, and we're going to move him to a new ministry position in the church, and maybe in the next couple weeks I'll tell you about some of the leadership changes and how the elders are going to function in our church. Big meeting tomorrow night on some of those changes. But Clay is here with us today, and Clay has been doing the young adult ministry here at our church for years and years. He's been doing it out of his home on Thursday night. Clay grew up here in the youth group here many, many years ago and has just been with us forever. So if you don't know Clay, Clay has been with us a long time. He's got a wonderful, wonderful wife we adore. I think we like Tana more than Clay. I'm kidding. Clay this week, just so you know, there's Michael coming through. Clay, just so you know, my conversation with Clay this week, so you know. He called me after being underneath a lady's mobile home that had a water leak this week. So just trying to brag on Clay a little bit. He's got a little bit of a fix-it gift in him, too, and he was out trying to help a lady that I had not got to yet, was on my way, but he got there before I did, which is wonderful, and Clay was trying to help in some of that. We love Clay. We see a ministry heart. I will tell you this, in our Holy Spirit class last winter, there was a prophetic word talking about Clay needing to be used, would be a dynamic leader in our church as an elder. So I'm trying right now to honor what the Lord spoke to us last winter about Clay's role in our church. So I'd love for you to include Clay today as an elder in our church. And then Justin's been our youth pastor for 3 years. Before that, he was 2 years at LifeNet. Before that, he was serving, has always been serving here in our youth ministry, all the way back until he was a young person in the youth ministry. So Justin's been here for a long time. Jamie can tell you stories. You want to hear a motivational story about a man that had a very broken life and how the Lord's just done a work in his life, just listen to Justin's story sometime. Just drug addiction and super poor. Not his drug addiction, but his parents' drug addiction, super, super poor, and how the Lord raised him up from the mud. Just an amazing story to work with kids here. I'm super excited about that. There's Brian. You know Brian. Brian's been a deacon here. We love Brian. Moving him over to the elder board to do more ministry in our church than paying the bills. We're just making a change there. And then Michael, has, at this moment in time, he has a lot of different abilities, but at this moment in time, he is over the kids' ministry. We're thrilled about all of those things. You guys all know there's a big 7 o'clock meeting tomorrow, right? Be there or we'll be in trouble. Not at my house. Not at my house. The men's Bible study. You know the men's Bible study moved to my house. You want to know why? Because I have guys in my house with ankle bracelets on. And the fellas in our church want to minister to them. So they're moving the men's Bible study to my house so guys with ankle bracelets can have ministry. Jamie, my wife. Well, that's a whole different story. I think she's on probation now, so we're okay. All right, so there they are, okay? There's the elders in the church. If you give them a hand, they serve with no money, trying to serve people. Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you all. Love you. Now, go get busy. Go get busy. Go help people. Good. Yeah. More ballots? Bruce has them right there. If you bring them, Bruce, bring them right up here as you come. You're a deacon, right? Now the deacons, fellas, come on. Deacons. These are the boys that do the business of the church. These are the men that do the business of the church. The men that do the business of the church. Here they are. Don, you okay, buddy? Good to see you. Jim Lee, right here on my right. Jim, wave. Yeah, Jim plays guitar here, and is an executive at Honda of America. I made that up. But Jim's been with Honda for a long time and has a heart for our church. I know he does. Dana. I'm the only guy that cries when he talks about his deacon, man. If it weren't for Dana, we'd be dead. If you knew the importance of Dana in our church, not just in the music ministry, but beyond all of that. I had to tell Dana yesterday in a situation. I looked at Dana, just we made eye contact. I said, Dana, thank you for helping me. Because Dana was helping me in a situation yesterday that only Dana could do. Plumbing situation. And Tony here, Tony's a great brother and friend, heart for everything we do here. Thrilled about him. He's helping more and more and more. Are you a one-termer? You've just been on a year, Tony? Or you've been on two? You've been on two. I'm sorry. Two or three? It just seems so new. You seem so young. So we're thankful about that. We're going to vote him in again because his kids have all moved to Indiana and we're trying to latch him down. Trying to lock me down. So love Tony. Bruce here does the missions work in our church. Mission pays all the missionaries in our church. Glad to have Bruce here, works in our sound. Just on and on with these brothers do. Don is just the most gracious, humble, wonderful man. Probably in our church. You knew Don, you'd know just a servant's heart. If I call, he comes. And believe it or not, he can fix about anything. Praying for his wife. Praying for his wife over there. Thinking about her, praying for her. And then Keith. Keith's the main treasurer here in our church. If you have any financial questions at all, you want to ask him. But all these brothers know the business of the church and have some knowledge of that. Keith knows the most. Okay? I will tell you, and they can tell you, as a pastor, I don't involve myself in the business of the church at all. If we're late on our electric bill this month, I don't know. I don't care. Okay? I really don't know what you give. It doesn't matter to me. Honestly, we try to talk about money very, very little here. It's a knock that the world has against the church, that it's all about money. And it's not about money. So we try to minimize any conversation we ever have about that because it's you've been good and blessed us, and we in turn want to bless you. These men serve with no pay, hours that nobody knows. And I'd like for you to vote yes for them today. If you vote no for anybody today, that's your prerogative, and please let me know why, because we want to go get them for that, okay? We want to take them out of the woodshed. I'm kidding. But for the most part, why did I say it like that? For in all parts, these men are good, wonderful men who serve the body of Christ here, okay? And we're blessed. I'm telling you, as a pastor, many, many pastors would love to be in the place I'm at because of the men who serve around me. I'm blessed. I want you to know I'm blessed. So these are our deacons, and we're very proud of them and present them to you today to vote for them. If you vote no, that's your prerogative. Please tell us why, because we'd like to get better, okay? Thank you for that. If you need them, yeah. Here's ballots. Thanks, guys. Here's ballots. If you need one today, I'll give them to you. You can, if you've got them already, you can put them in the offering plate as it goes around just now. Or I can give these to you, and you can hand them to, let's do it this way. There'll be offering plates down here on this heater. That you can put your bulletin or these ballots in after service, okay, if you need to do that. But anybody who would like to vote, we'd like to really say to the state members vote, okay? So if you need this, we'd love to give it to you right now, okay? Enough about that. It's the only time of the year we ever do that, just now. You won't hear about that any again until next year, all right? Thank you. Thank you. Father, we bless you this morning. Very, very grateful for all that we have. Lord, the opportunity we have here in Westville, Ohio, to serve you. Pray, Lord, that you bless our offering as we pass these plates today. Bless those, Lord, who participate in giving to you. Lord, help those who struggle in all of that, I pray today. And Lord, be mighty in our church service. Meet every need we have, from big to little, Lord. We don't have to mention those things to you because you already know. But in this day, Lord, would you show your presence? Would you reveal yourself and give us help and strength and healing where we need it? So, Lord, do your work among your people. Minister to us today in song and in word, Lord, and we'll be glad. Very, very thankful for opportunity and time together. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
To the Lord this morning. Father God, we need you this morning. Father God, we praise you and give you this time, Lord. Lord, we're so thankful to come together here this morning, Lord. We just need your presence here, Father. Let your spirit come down in this place, Father God. Father God, you are the great almighty King. Father, you're the healer, the protector, the provider, Father God. When we trust in the Lord and we accept Jesus as our Savior, we are born into His family as children of God. Amen? Are you a child of God this morning? As a child of God, we have no fear. We should not fear because our Father in heaven, the creator of all the universe and all things, He's our protector. He is our Father. Hallelujah. Ponder that this morning, right now, in this moment. And let's sing praises to Him. Hallelujah. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies to all my fears. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. This world, you have chosen me. Father, we're thankful. Hallelujah. Father, we need more of you. This next song talks about setting a fire. Now I want more of you in my life, Father. That's the choice you have to make is, Father, I want more of you. And that's when it kindles something inside you, a burning fire inside you to go after him. And that's what he desires in our lives. And that's when you become who he made you for. Father, let us be that. Hallelujah. We need you, Lord. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more. God, I want more of you, God. You set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. The Lord. Amen. If you need the Lord, say amen right now. Amen. Father God, we're here because of you, Lord. We give you these songs of praise because of you, because of what you've been in our lives and what you're doing in our lives and what you have to come, Father, until the moment we see you face to face, Father God. Give you these songs of love, Father God. We're all here in agreement, declaring you the King of our lives, Father God. The purpose of our life, Father. We don't know what tomorrow brings, Father. We trust you. We trust in you, Lord. Guide us, Father. Love you and praise you. Speak now through our pastor. And we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
How I need you. Do, 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 do. Do 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 do. Hi friend, how you doing? Bo do 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 do. Jesus, you're my hope. Lord, I need you. Yes, I need you every hour. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good to see everybody. My one defense, my righteousness. Don, we okay? You okay? Yeah, all right. Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Good to see you. Glad you're here. A lot of stuff, good stuff on my mind. I got a mom that's failing very quickly, and Jim's not here today, so that's always a bad sign. My mom is failing, and anyhow, if you remember my mom and lift her up, she put most of the good stuff I got in me. The rest of it my wife put in me, so nothing good on my own. Somebody else poured that in me. And the Lord knocked me around a while until I woke up some, and that was good. It's our finest hour. I know it sounds crazy. It's our finest hour, man. Glad you're here. So glad you're here preaching today. Excited about preaching today. Fired up about everything. I will say to you, all month long, this month, people brought food to our house. And it has been amazing. It's been amazing. Cheryl gets on me because I always want to say, don't do that. It's too much work. It's too much work for you all. You guys don't need that. You got plenty to do. I recognize it. Almost everybody works and you got stuff to do. And Cheryl keeps saying to me, stop that. Stop that. We want to bless you. I'm like, I know, but golly gee. But my wife is thrilled. She's thrilled. She's told me the same thing. I've told people, don't bring anything. We're okay. My wife says, no, we're not. And the fellows that live with us are blessed, and they're excited as a new car pulls in every night, and they're excited, and it's been delicious. I mean, almost beyond delicious. We've had, you don't realize this, but just to tell you, we feed guys in our house through that, and then I take anything that's left over to the shop next door, and there's men that work in the shop next door the next day, and they're blessed again. So when people bring us food, there's probably 15 or so men blessed by that. So we've been thrilled. We've just been so excited. The other night, Danielle got too much pizza for the kids' event. We had a kids' event. I shouldn't say she got too much. I think she got just right, but the weather was cold, and the turnout was down a little bit, cold and dark a little bit. But the kids were pulling pumpkins back on these big slingshots and firing them at a target that was in the pond. You talk about cool. You talk about a little boy fun thing. That's a blast. But she bought a bunch of pizzas for that, and some were left over. And, Erica got a hold of those pizzas that were left over and brought them to us. Somebody had already brought us food that night, so we ended up with five or six big pizzas. I put them in the shop refrigerator. I think there were six pizzas. I went back over the next night just to check on how things were. There was a pizza and a half left. So there were five pizzas eaten that day in the shop. So just to try to tell you, blessed. Thank you for all that. We're very happy to be pastoring here. I'm not saying, you've already voted, so I'm not saying that to get your vote. Thanks for everything, okay? Thank you much for everything. My wife will formally come up here next week and thank you from her lips. Okay? Like I'm the boss around there, you know. She usually tells me what I'm going to do. So glad you came today. Thanks for coming. Try to teach a whole bunch this morning. Hope you enjoy it. If you're trying to figure me out, the Lord just has had me in the Old Testament some. I don't preach a lot out of the Old Testament. We're kind of busting through the Old Testament. Actually, we're just ahead of what we're teaching in the Bible for Dummies class. So I've been running just a little bit ahead of what we're teaching on Sunday nights here. You're still welcome to come to that if you'd like. So all those things. It seems like there's some other things I want to say to you. Thank you. When I get to heaven, I don't know how to say this to you. When we all get to heaven, we'll recognize all the little things that God kept record of. A kind word. Bible says he keeps record of giving someone a cold glass of water.
you may not think you're doing big, but listen, out of the goodness of your heart, just serving little by little, every time you do good, the Lord records that for eternity. You're blessed for eternity in doing that. You can't outgive God. And the Bible says, lay up treasures in heaven. Right? Everything here kind of rusts and goes away, but those things that are done for a heavenly cause remain forever. So, encouraging some of that. Just let the Lord use you in big and little, okay? You're okay with that? Bless you for that. Father, would you do a work that no man can do? Would you speak to a congregation today? Use this man right here. God, if that's what you are doing this morning, I pray, God, that you just use a pastor to speak to a church. You set it up that way, Lord, in the body of Christ. So, God, I stand on a stage not because I'm anybody, but because you called me here. You've gathered people, Lord, to hear your word. God, I pray, Lord, that it's spoken, and I pray, God, that it's received, and I pray, God, that we are moved in a way that we didn't see coming, that our hearts are enlarged today. So, Father, do your work. Do it powerfully, wonderfully among us even now. In Jesus' name, amen. Book of Daniel today. We're just kind of, last week we were in Isaiah. We're trying to go real quick. Daniel today. Daniel is some of you may know what this is, but he's a prophet. A prophet meaning God showed him what would come, and he began to write that. But he was a prophet in the time of the exile period. You might know what that is. There's a period in Jewish history where their enemies completely defeated them, and they were taken away, in this case, to Babylon for 70 years. Everybody know that? So after they had sinned against God and come back and sinned against God and come back and sinned against God and come back, finally the Lord said their sin got increasingly worse, allowed a man by the name of Nebuchadnezzar. That's a spelling word for you right there. That's quite a spelling word, okay? Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, came down, invaded. Finally, in 586 BC, he takes over the last of the Jewish people, the nation of Judah, okay? And Daniel is a prophet in the period of this exile period, in the 70-year period there. And Daniel never really ever lives in his homeland. He's a Jew in a far land. You catching that? He grows up from a young boy, kind of serving in the king's palace. He was one of those people. God put him in the right place. And what the gifting that Daniel receives is a gifting where he can interpret dreams. Pretty interesting. My wife has a story. If you ever get a chance to talk to her, she dreamed a dream of 4 or 5 years ago that she had no idea what it meant. It was pretty intense. The details of any spiritual dream you have are very important. If you ever have a spiritual dream, every little detail is significant. She asked me, the guru of dreams, to interpret that dream for her, and I said I had no idea what it meant. It was goofy. I thought maybe she'd eaten too much spicy pizza or something the night before, and that's why she was dreaming. But the truth of the matter, she has a very detailed dream. It was in two phases. And she ended up doing what all smart people do, just getting on the internet and asking somebody what it meant. You're supposed to be laughing. Come on. She found these people in Canada, I think, that were specialists in interpreting dreams. And they wrote back to her exactly what we're living in today. What God was about to do in our life. The dream that she had had minute details of what God was about to do with us. And as I stand here 4 years after she had that dream, we're doing exactly what the dream said we would be doing. And it's amazing. So I believe in spiritual dreams. I'm seeing them happen in my life. I believe the Lord's given me a couple really serious spiritual dreams. And the Lord might give you those. Don't let those things go. They're very prophetic often about what the Lord is trying to reveal in your life, you know. And one of the ways God often reveals things to us is through dreams. Okay? Usually those things are very vivid, they're very detailed. you usually have no idea what they mean, because God's trying to speak something in a picture, in a movie clip, kind of what your dream is, a movie clip, those things that might be ahead. And I've had people over the years share with me many times the dreams they've had. And just, wow. John had a dream. Didn't you have a dream? Sad. And it happened. Didn't it happen just like, wow. And I could go on and on and on about those things, but Daniel has the ability to interpret dreams. And so let me do it. So what the Lord did was started giving the king, Nebuchadnezzar, started giving him dreams, and the kings that would follow. So guess what? Daniel becomes this very important guy to be able to interpret the dreams that nobody else can interpret, that the king, in fact, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream, and he calls together all his wise magicians and all of them and says, interpret the dream. And they say, tell us the dream. And he says, I'm not going to tell you the dream. So he wanted an interpretation of the dream by somebody who didn't, he wouldn't even tell him what it was. But Daniel was able to tell him the dream and then the interpretation. Just amazing. And we're going to get into a little bit of that today, okay? How God uses us, how God's trying to reveal things to us. And we're going to talk about these prophetic things that Daniel prophesied that are still to come true now. I mean, in fact, trying to inspire the church that what some things that Daniel said, we're living in right now in an amazing way. So this is how it begins, Daniel 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. It's what I just told you. This guy was the king. Nebuchadnezzar came and took him over. Next verse, I think, just continues that. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into the hand and some of the articles of the house of God, which was carried to the land of Shinar, the house of his God, meaning Nebuchadnezzar's God. And he brought the articles into the treasure house of his God. So not only did he defeat the people, drag them back to Babylon, he also took a lot of the sacred items out of the temple of God and took those back also. That's important for some things we'll know later. So Nebuchadnezzar conquers them and takes them back. Okay, that's just the beginning of the book of Daniel. We get to Daniel chapter 2. Nebuchadnezzar has a dream. This is an important dream. In fact, I probably could tell you, oh, he destroys the city. This is a picture of Nebuchadnezzar taking the people out, destroying the city, destroys the temple and the walls. Solomon's great temple is destroyed here. Okay? All right, next slide, Cullen. In this second dream, I can read it to you, second chapter. Is that Betty back there? That's Betty. I'll tell you this. Betty looked a little tired before church today. I said, Betty, don't fall asleep on me. She's doing the center screen here. She said, don't be boring. So if there's some things said specifically at Betty today, okay, so I'll fire a few shots that way. Just let them go, okay? Would you do that? I just don't want to be boring. This is the dream that he has. In fact, we'll read just a minute. This is a dream, and is interpreted. Now, we will tell the interpretation of it before the king. Go ahead. O king, or the king of kings. Now, that isn't capitalized, so he isn't the king of kings in heaven. He's just the king of kings on earth. That makes sense? For the God of heaven has given you the kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. Go. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field, or the birds of the heaven, he has given them into your hand, and has made you ruler over them all. You are the head of gold. See that? And I could go read on here. It's in the second chapter of Daniel. But let me just real quickly, just for time's sake, because I want to preach some other verses to you. He has a dream, basically, that Daniel interprets about the future kingdoms of the world. You catching that? And after the Babylonian kingdom was the Mede-Persian kingdom, and after the Mede-Persian kingdom, the Greek kingdom, and then the Roman, and then ultimately this iron and clay kingdom, which is the kingdom of the Antichrist. These are worldwide kingdoms where a single leader ruled the world. Does that make sense? We have senators get up in the U.S. Congress and say, this is the greatest nation ever on the face of the earth. And I want to tell you, the United States has been this amazing vessel God has used to spread the gospel throughout the whole world. But I also want to tell you, we didn't even make the dream. Let me go on about the United States for a minute, because I don't want you to feel like I'm slamming on the United States. God put us here. to spread the gospel to the whole earth in a period of time when the older nations of the world were leaving God. God rose up a powerful, godly nation to pour back into those nations of the world. And the Bible says, go into all the earth and preach the gospel. You get that whole thing? There are people come to me sometimes and say, I don't want anything to go to foreign missions. Do missions around here. And I always tell people, we're working here as hard as we possibly can. We're doing ministry every day, all the time, here, present. You know what I mean? Your church is giving away a semi-load of food every week. I don't know if you know how many people, how many families are being fed out of LifeNet Church. It's absolutely incredible and amazing. Half of Urbana, I should say, a third of Urbana, a fourth of Urbana, something like that, goes to LifeNet Church 3 weeks out of the month to get food. We are moving food like you can't believe, doing ministry you can't believe, counseling and marrying and doing and moving and all that stuff. You hear me? But God said, go into all the world. The whole purpose for the church in the United States of America was to spread the gospel back into the whole earth. Everybody get that? And people who say to me, I don't believe in foreign missions, then you've missed what God was trying to do with the American church. I'm not trying to say it in a blunt way, but that's exactly what the American church was established to do, to pour and go into all the world and preach the gospel. I will tell you right now, as we're having church right now, because of Renewed Strength Church, there are church services happening up and down rivers in Peru, in war-torn countries, in the dark places in Africa, just in Haiti. Renewed Strength Church has the ability, thank God, praise the Lord, to help people do ministry all over this planet. We've purposely tried to pick people from different continents that we've had confidence in, and literally, as we're preaching this morning, the ministry that you have invested in is doing things around the world. Amazing. For this little church, it's amazing. I don't know if you saw the presentation Wednesday night, but this church, compared to the national average, I forget what, the national average gives 9%. I think it is, of their money to missions work. I think this church gives 32% of its income to missions work. Something to that effect. But let's get it right here when it comes to the kingdoms of this world. Nebuchadnezzar has a dream, and Daniel interprets it, and it's pretty amazing that these are the future kingdoms of the world. Now, you know, Daniel lived in this time period. He also saw some of these kings before he died. But the truth of the matter is, in 2 Daniel here, Daniel the second chapter, he sees all of this, and all of this comes true. This last kingdom, hey, these feet have 10 toes, represents a future worldwide kingdom. The Antichrist is going to rule over probably 10 divisions of financial divisions of the whole earth. We have a G9 meeting, a big financial meeting. Nine nations, the biggest nine nations economies of the world, are already meeting, have a monetary policy for the nine industrialized, biggest industrialized countries of the world already. You catching that? If you knew how all this is falling together, it is amazing. And Daniel, what, 600 years, 2,600 years ago, says these things. Most of the things interpreted in this dream had not come to pass, but over hundreds of years in the future, from Daniel's perspective, these things happen just as he said they would. That's Daniel chapter 2. Let's go Daniel 3. Nebuchadnezzar, because he realizes he's the greatest king that ever lived, according to the dream that he has, you know what he does with that? Because he hasn't got the God thing yet. He builds a golden statue to himself. And every time they play music, you know what everybody has to do? Bow down and worship it. You know, I just want to tell you this, that you know the Antichrist will do a similar thing. Anyhow, so you can see here in the picture, that was okay for most of the people to bow down because they were pretty fearful of Nebuchadnezzar. But for those Jewish men that had been taken there, that knew who their God was, they weren't bowing down to some golden statue. And these young men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, become famous. Become very famous. You get that? Because they don't bow down. You know the end of the story here. Just show me the picture. Daniel chapter 3. The picture is this. Three were cast in, but there's four in a fiery furnace. I don't know what kind of fiery things. You know, the New Testament teaches us that fire purifies us. So next time you're in a fiery trial, just rejoice. Everybody here like, oh yeah. Love fiery trials. Just love them. But know this, that Jesus is there with you. As I speak to you today, the Bible teaches us really clearly that Jesus walked in our footsteps. He knows our trials. He knows our tribulation. He was tempted in all ways. So when you pray to Jesus, I'm telling you, He knows exactly what you're going through. You hear me? And He'll go through those fiery trials. And He'll be right there in the fire. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, You're with me. We see these amazing things that Daniel walked through and how they had to stand for their faith. I just say this to you because I want you to know this, that we may end up living in the days of Daniel, just to let you know. There are prophets now in our country, and I'm not saying whether they're wrong or right, but there are national prophets who have God has used before, saying now, and they said it a year or so ago, but saying that one Supreme Court justice will die. That's already happened. A second one will retire. Two more will quit because of scandal. And Trump may have the opportunity to appoint four Supreme Court justices. You know what happens when he appoints four Supreme Court justices? Come on now. Roe versus Wade gets, abortion goes away. You know what happens in our country when Roe versus Wade goes away? You know what happens? That's right. I saw somebody go, gay marriage, the ruling on gay marriage could very easily go away. You know, our country can be split in the near future, if those prophets are right, could be split in the near future based on righteous judgments. And our nation could end up being very, very divided because some stand for God. What's that? What happens to that when the people, the majority of the people who believe in unrighteousness want these things to remain, and all of a sudden those laws get turned back, or the argument that's coming ahead? I'm telling you, people have been praying since 1971 that Roe versus Wade. Has God's ear been deaf towards that? Watch. Watch. Someday you'll call me a genius. It's coming. Those prophets are right. Things like that are coming. But here we see it in Daniel's case. Bow down, bow down. No, no, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not bow down. Jesus was in the fire with them. And they walked out, the Bible says, and they didn't even smell like smoke. What does that mean to you? You hear these Bible stories. You think the Lord loves them more than He loves you? The one thing I've learned over the years is God loves me. I always doubted, I don't know if you know this, but I grew up as a poor, just a super poor country kid. My mom, the story about some of ours, my mom, before she'd pay a dime for something at a garage sale, make us try it on. I used to be so embarrassed that most of our clothes came from garage sales and that we had to try on clothes at a garage sale. I'm like, Mom, it's a dime. Come on, I don't want to try these on. I grew up, one thing that I grew up in was this feeling that I wasn't special, I wasn't important, I didn't have anything, I was nobody. That's just funny how God puts me on a stage. Isn't that funny? Isn't that funny? The person who least expected that he'd ever be anything is the person God does that to. I don't know, sometimes I'm mad at Him or not mad at Him. I'm not sure, you know, I don't understand all God or why God does, but the truth of the matter is He knows you. He knows you. Way before time began, He knew you, the Bible says. Before the foundation of the earth was laid, you were, and He chose you for this time. It wasn't just Esther. Come on. Just Esther was chose for that moment. You know what I mean? Purpose for that. No, no. In that time, there was a recognition that this young girl was purposed for just that moment. You know what I mean? But it's true for every one of us that we were purposed for this moment. If you think God purposed you to be a lukewarm dish rag, then believe that. You know what I mean? But I'm telling you, the Lord purposed us for something amazing and special. You hear me? Greatness in us. Greatness that comes from Father God, who put it in us from birth. Have no idea what God wants us to be or do or speak or stand for. But there'll come a day when God's preparing all of our hearts to step into our holy purpose, you know what I mean, and make a difference in this crazy world. Because you were created to make a difference. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they didn't know that was coming. They just knew who their God was. That makes sense? They knew who He was. And they wouldn't bow to another. I don't know how that's hitting you today. You're being awful still. What if we go there? What if these Bible stories, which I told, what if these Bible stories end up becoming like that in our day? Very similar. That's Daniel chapter 3. We're going to skip to Daniel chapter 5. Daniel chapter 5. Show me the picture here. Daniel chapter 5, the Mede-Persian king comes into power. And he's having a big party, drinking out of the gold vessels that were supposed to be holy out of the temple in Daniel chapter 5. And a finger comes from nowhere and starts writing on the wall. What was that? One of those goofy monster shows had a hand. Oh, Addams Family. And there was a hand, you know what I mean? And I always thought that was the goofiest thing ever. But can you imagine a hand showing up and writing something on the wall? What if a hand appeared and wrote in that wall right there? It'd be like, whoa. But in the big king's party, in the middle of his unrighteous stuff, not caring about God or God things, a hand shows up and writes on the wall. And this is the inscription. Me. I always want to say Taco Ferris. That's how I learned it as a kid. Next verse. In the interpretation of this word, me, God has numbered your kingdom and finished it. And that very day, that very night, that king's killed and his kingdom comes to an end. God will only put up with unrighteousness so long. God will deal with it. I believe, and forgive me, I try not to be political, even though I got very strong political feelings. Our country, in its unrighteousness, could not go on any longer. And an outsider, that I don't know what we think about him, God's raised him up to try to change some of the ungodly ways we are headed down. In just a moment, in an election that nobody expected, there was a change happened in America. Now, don't let me go any farther, because the guy we got, I could choke at times. But God has done something to change the direction our country was going. There's a book out right now by Jonathan Cahn. Some of the people in the first services are reading it, where it details the parallel between our presidents. It's called The Paradigm. Details our presidents paralleling the kings of Israel to the year, to the day, to events in such an amazing way. It's almost like we're repeating Old Testament history, and God's allowing it to happen. What happened in the Old Testament now again is happening again through the leaders of Israel. It happened originally, and now it's happening through the presidents of the United States. And it is drop your jaw amazing. The guy that wrote The Harbinger now has wrote something called The Paradigm. And it's just looking at these parallels in our present day that are amazing. That's what happened in Daniel 5. Daniel 6, Daniel gets thrown in the lion's den. Everybody heard that story? King Darius doesn't know any better, so he writes this thing and says, hey, anybody that prays to any other god than Darius, because in that day they often thought of themselves as God, I'm going to throw in the lion's den. He was close to Daniel, and he didn't realize that these people were trying to trap Daniel, but this is what happens. As soon as he signs that proclamation, Daniel chapter 6. Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home, and in his upper room, with his windows open toward Jerusalem, he knelt down on his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since early days. So they signed a law saying you can't pray to any god except for the god Darius, you know, the emperor. And Daniel goes home, throws his windows open, and just starts praying to the God Almighty. Guess where he ends up at? I don't know why. Why does God have to take us through the lion's den sometimes? You know, the hardest part about Christian living is thinking God doesn't always save us from trouble. We started with a song today. Lord, I thought you were going to come down and wipe our tears away. But once again, I say amen. I think I go, because it's still raining. Some of us this morning have a sorrow in our heart. We might think it may never go away. Why it had to work the way, and why did God not become the victor? Why was he not our champion? But really, when we look at the Old Testament, we begin to see that God allowed men to walk through things. That makes sense. God didn't always save us from everything. Although he'll save us from hell to come, he often in this world lets us just walk through hard things. The purpose and all that, I just tell you, just my belief is because this world is not our home. And if we were to be victorious in all these things, all of a sudden we start looking to this world as being the solution, when this world is not anything like the solution. It keeps us looking forward. Does that make sense? God allows things to happen. It keeps us hoping for his return, needing him more and more. So God often allows us just to walk through hard things, hoping that God will come and heal, and hoping that God will come and do and fix and change. But God often just walks us through those things, trying to use us as a light in the darkness. Daniel, trust me in all of this, is witnessing to people. When he pops out of that lion's den and doesn't have a mark on him, you know what I mean? It's a witness to the whole country. God often is using us as a witness, walking us through dark places to a family, to a church, to a people, about the goodness of God and the strength we have in the hard places we get from him. Sometimes a miracle isn't that he saves or that he heals or that he fixes. Sometimes a miracle is that we have strength to go on. I choose to be happy. I choose to have right attitudes, right? I choose a whole bunch of things. Try not to get my life on this world, but try to remind myself every day that this world is not my home. This is a journey, a process of, this is on the road to heaven. You know what I mean? This is the journey to get us to heaven. And in that day, no more pain, no more sorrow. You get all that? But on this journey, there's going to be valleys we walk through. I wish the Lord said, you know, I'll keep you from the valley of shadow of death. But no, what to say? He'll walk with us through the valley of shadow of death. There's Daniel chapter 6. Next set of verses. Cullen, Betty, are you awake? Try to think of a good one. I'll get her here in a minute. I'll get her. She's back here. Trust me, she's awake. She don't know what's coming just yet. Daniel chapter 7. Well, there's this dream that comes, and Daniel again is interpreting these things, or an angel that comes and he gets spoken to by an angel of the four great beasts. You didn't realize Daniel is such this amazing book. Let me just tell you something about these four great beasts. The first beast that's mentioned in Daniel chapter 7 is this lion that has wings on it, but the wings get separated from it and fly on their own. I think it's one of those pictures of Great Britain, and the wings are actually the United States of America. Often the wings of eagles, or eagles, when eagles are mentioned in the scripture, often that might be the mention, because the United States of America has been one of the only nations that have been identified as an eagle. You catching that? So if you read here, you see in these last days there'll be four great beasts that appear. Great Britain with the wings of an eagle. A bear with three bones and three ribs in its mouth. I'm teaching you stuff. Listen to me. I'm teaching you stuff other pastors don't even touch. Russia is the great bear. Hadn't that the nation has been? And there are three little teeny countries that stand for between them and Israel. We think that eventually they'll invade those countries so they have a clear access into Israel. The bear with three little ribs in its mouth. The lion, four-headed lion. You know, Hitler was the Third Reich, the leopard. I'm sorry, did I say lion? Leopard. Help me, John. Leopard with four heads. Hitler was the Third Reich. You know, the Fourth Reich. They're even talking in that term. The Fourth Rising of Germany is occurring now. The leopard with the fourth head. You didn't realize it was happening right now, did you? You didn't realize that in Daniel chapter 7, the nations that would exist in the end days, which are right now even described by the animals they're described by, are in the story in Daniel chapter 7. And then the fourth beast is this great dreadful beast that has 10 horns, and it's a future kingdom. Again, where the statue had 10 toes. I told you there might be 10 divisions of the earth. Another representation of 10 divisions of the earth. A dreadful, awful creature. And that's what Daniel describes in Daniel chapter 7. Finally, I want to get to where I want to preach, finally. Wow. Daniel chapter 9. They say Daniel chapter 9. We're going to look at the verses here, Colin, Betty. Daniel chapter 9. They say is one of the greatest prophecies there is in the scripture. I'll tell you why in just a minute. Let's go back to 18, Colin. Can you jump back a verse? Daniel is praying, repenting of sin. He says, listen, Lord, our nation has been ungodly. Please restore to us. Please, God, restore to us our homeland again. God, please, we forgive us, oh God, forgive us. We've been wicked. He says this at the end of the prayer. Oh my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolation. Look where we are, Lord. Look where we are. And the city which is called your name by your name. He's talking about Jerusalem. What happened to Jerusalem, Lord? Lord, look at us. Hear us, please. God, what happened to your people? He's repenting and saying, God, we're sorry. Lord, look what's happened. Look where we are. For we do not present our supplications before you because of our righteous deeds, but because of your great mercies. I almost put that in the bulletin today. So Lord, we're not coming to you because we're good. We're coming to you, God, only because you're merciful. Lord, would you help us in this thing? And I think because he prays that, hey, look here, verse 20, Daniel 9:20. Now while I was speaking, praying and confessing my sins and the sin of the people of Israel and presenting my supplication before the Lord my God for the holy mountain of my God. Go ahead. Yes, while I was speaking in prayer, a man Gabriel, whom I had seen in a vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, reached me about the time of the evening sacrifice. You getting this? While I was praying, Gabriel showed up. Next one. Most amazing thing. And he informed me and talked with me, saying, and said, O Daniel, I have now come forth to give you skill and understanding. So Daniel's praying, saying, God, please pay attention. Please, Lord, we're your people. Lord, please come and help us in this place. God, we're not good, but you're merciful. And the Lord sends Gabriel and says, hey, I'm going to give you some understanding. Now watch this. Next one. At the beginning of your supplication, the command went out, and I have come to tell you, for you are greatly beloved. Therefore, consider the matter and vision and understanding the vision. Go. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end to sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up the vision and prophecy, to anoint the most holy. You're like, what? Let me give you understanding, Daniel. It's going to be 70 weeks. You're like, what? 70 weeks. Go on here. And it's all going to be over in 70 weeks. Know, therefore, and understand from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until the Messiah, the Prince, there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the walls, even in troublesome times. So Daniel's saying, God, restore us. Lord, we're sinners. Forgive us. Your great compassion, your great mercy. And the Lord sends Gabriel to give him understanding. And he says, there's going to be 70 weeks. And we've come to have understanding that those 70 weeks we're talking about, God was going to deal with the people, with the Jews, for 70 weeks. Now, those weeks are really 7 years. So every time we talk about a week, we're talking about a 7-year period. And then it divides that up here, and I know it gets a little complicated, but it divides that up into a 7-week period and a 62-week period. Here's a chart. You ready? From the time the commandment is given to rebuild the temple, after this prophecy, Cyrus, the Persian king, at some point, just in a day, makes a command that they can go back and rebuild the temple. There's a moment when that happens. Daniel prophesies it. There's a moment in the future when that happens. 49 weeks after that, 7 weeks, which is 49 years, 7 times 7, 49 years, hey, that's rebuilt. We know that. We actually even know the year of that. We know when the command was given. We know when that was actually completed. You know when it happened? It was 7 times 7. It was 49 years. Daniel prophesies all this, and it's all in the future. But then he says, a period of 62 weeks until the Messiah, the Prince. You see that? 62 weeks, 7 times 62 is 434. 434 years after the temple and the walls were completed. 434 years exactly. You know, they've studied that. They know the exact day because the Bible tells the exact Jewish day in the month. 434 years after the temple was completed. You know what that day was? Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. The very day the Messiah, to the very day. 434. That's why they say this prophecy is one of the most amazing prophecies ever in the Scripture. That he predicted 7 weeks, which is 49 years exactly, and it came to pass exactly. And, well, 434 years later, the Messiah comes exactly to the day. What the prophets don't tell us about, and it really isn't in many prophetic things at all, is that there's a period here, Messiah's cut off, and there's a period here, a 2,000-year period that most prophets don't even tell us about because it's a period for the Gentile. The prophets in the Old Testament had no idea that God was going to minister for 2,000 years to the Gentile. So often you see in the Scripture the prophecy about the Jews. You catching this? And in the middle of that, there's a comma that really represents 2,000 years. So there's some prophecies. It says we'll go from here to here with a comma between, and that's a 2,000-year comma. The prophets didn't see the period, they didn't see the church age at all. Jesus begins to teach about the church age. Does everybody get that whole thing? Jesus came to fulfill the law and the prophets. You get that? And he began to talk about a church. He began to talk about a people. And he rose up these apostles who went into the Gentile nations. And for 2,000 years, the Lord opened the doors for us people, us guys, you know, us unholy, heathen Gentiles to know a way, have a path to God. You're going to get to heaven someday, and all these Jews that sacrificed all these bulls and all these goats and all this stuff are going to say, man, you got in easy. We had to do all this work. We had to do all this stuff, and Jesus did all your work. And we're going to say, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's right. Thank you, Jesus. Because the Jews rejected Jesus, he went on to another people. Hey, and the fulfillment of those days is near its end. You hear that? But we've covered 69 weeks, and the Daniel prophecy was for 7 weeks, right? So what remains is 1 week. Beth Moore teaches it like this, that God was on the phone with the Jews for 493 years, 69 weeks. And then he said, hold on for a minute, lays the phone down, and works with the Gentiles for 2,000 years. But in the very last day, he picks the phone back and say, okay, guys, 7 more years. Those 7 years represent a future time called the tribulation. Hey, and the whole purpose for the tribulation, really, is many will come to the Lord. But the Jews will begin to cry out to Jesus as a Messiah. 69 weeks have already taken place. Daniel says 70 weeks. 1 week, or a period of 7 years, is still in the future. Right here in Daniel chapter 9. I'm out of time. Daniel chapter 12 is where I wanted to end. Daniel does it again in the first 4 verses, some amazing things. The Lord knows. To the very day. You don't think He knows you? There's a song that came out. I'm just trying to end. There's a song that came out. My daughter loves it. She got me listening to it. And it talks about every moment of my life. You know the reason why. Every trial, every storm, you were there. I don't need to know why. I just believe it's you. And I've showed you today how a prophet 2,600 years ago, hey, it still has got everything right the whole way, still has a few more things to go. But how God knew from the very beginning of time the story of you. He knew. He knew when I was mad at Mom about the dime pair of pants, you know, the corduroys that we used to buy. He knew that was all for my good. He knew that I needed to get that job in Dayton right beside the Bible college he wanted me to go to. He knew there was an old building here that had been abandoned, and he knew the man to come fix it. He knew you. He knows your trouble. He knows your joy. He knows your sorrow. He knows your pain. He doesn't want you stuck in that. You know, often the trick of the devil is we get stuck in that forever. The devil wants us to freeze us, and God's trying to set us free. God's trying to give us this great hope that everything that's broken in a last day, it'll all be repaired. So live! Live! Don't fall for the enemy's tricks. Walk in God's holy purpose. Amen? Father, we give you praise this day. Just teaching today about Daniel and what he saw all those many years ago and how it's all come true. I remember driving home, Lord, from Bible college, just thinking, Lord, you orchestrated all that and I'm worried about me? But the days would come when my dad would die young, my parents would divorce, pain and sorrow would come in, people would reject me, churches would hurt me, nobody would understand, I didn't know how, Lord. I didn't know how you were going to do it. I was fearful and afraid and didn't know, Lord. At times I didn't trust you. At times I was angry, Lord. I was so angry at you. But you kept being patient with me, Lord. You just kept being patient. You did everything in the world, Lord. Did everything you could to not let me go back to who I used to be. And every day, Lord, you'd give me strength. And every once in a while, you'd give me a new hope or a new sense of help. And I would trudge on, Lord, praying and asking you, Lord, to reveal yourself. Hallelujah. And you send people to come, Lord, and encourage me. And somehow you'd make a way from day to day. And somehow, Lord, when I couldn't pay the bill, Lord, you paid the bill. When I didn't know what I'd do, Lord, somehow you made a way. When I was in the desert, Lord, you sent rain. And you've been doing it for the ages, Lord, over all these ages, over all these men. God, how you've arrived, how you've done what we didn't think you would do, and how we've had to endure things we thought we'd never have to endure. But how the God, the great God of heaven, has been faithful over and over and over and over. Daniel prayed, God, open your ears. And open your eyes. It's not because we're anything, Lord. But because of your great compassion, God, help us. Lord, we've not achieved. We've not come to some great place, Lord, where we're some great church or some great people. We're sinners saved by a great God who gives us great grace. And it's by your mercy, Lord, we're saved. We say thank you. And we march on, Lord. We march on. You've reminded us today your faithfulness to a man who didn't even have a homeland, who longed for something his eyes never saw. How you spoke to him about things that he would never enjoy or understand, but how all of it came true. Encourage us this day, I pray, Lord, about a faithful God who walks with us all the time. Encourage us this day, Lord, to be faithful and true. May your church, Lord, be a blessing to you and a light to the world. Accomplish that right here, Lord, I pray. Through your people who love you. We give you thanks, Lord, glory and honor for all that's accomplished for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming. Everybody, good you were here. Hope you'll come back and see us again real soon. Amen. Wow. Wow. Whoa. 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 Sometimes, man. It doesn't happen all the time.